Greetings, unsettled souls. Aw, Christelle doesn't have the sound up. Aw, Christelle. It's awful low in here. You're listening to The Correct Views. Sam, I beat a Gangi during political commentary on the media speaks. The sound is low, and the shin hurts. Can't move in the studio. You just can't move anywhere that I go. I'm like a rat going through a Skinner box. It's more like a rat going through a mouse's Skinner box. Hit my leg so hard before I went on, I'm literally bleeding off camera. And still I go onward. Blasting news. You can tell, this really hurts. Full list of news outlets banned by Donald Trump. Others boycott White House. Donald Trump has banned several news outlets from taking part in the White House press briefing, and other publications are not calling for a boycott. Let me tell you a little personal story. It's about Donald Trump and how he censored me. Okay. It's how I was censored by Donald Trump. I went to see him with Christelle. We went to see him the first time he spoke in the area that I knew of. And it was Cleveland, Ohio. We drove up there, and they wouldn't let us bring our tripod in. They wouldn't let us bring our camera in. You know what I did? I'll tell you what I did. I took protest signs, like the one you see behind me, the Trump logo there. You guys off camera, you're going to have to just trust me. Right here, I can do this. There you go. Ooh, like that one right there. We took it and we rolled it into a tube, a long tube. We then took these bracelets, like you see them that I wear compulsively, and I wrapped them around the tube, stuck my cell phone on top of the tube, and proudly hoisted it into the air, using nothing that wasn't already permitted to be in the building. I can't say the Secret Service looked pleased, but I didn't break any rules. The second time, Donald Trump promised me tickets when I was invited to go. So I picked up a writing job to write about the... I got like 20, 25, 30 bucks I was supposed to get to write about the event. So I drove up there, and lo and behold, they oversold it. So the third time, I was on the Trump mailing list by then, having been a proud rider of the Trump train. I got a press pass. Well, first of all, they asked me if I wanted to go, and I said no, because the last time, I think I said, why should I go? You left me standing outside last time, humiliated me in front of an editor. They replied by giving me press passes. Now, does that mean, thank you, Mr. Trump, does that mean that the first two times I was censored or banned? Well, let's see. I could print whatever I wanted. I could say whatever I wanted. I had said that I thought Trump did a very, I was getting overwhelmed with how, at the time, one of the few concerns I had was that Donald Trump was being overwhelmed, and that it's possible that he would have very good policies, but that the nuts and bolts of being a president could maybe be a problem. And we're seeing a moderate amount of leaks, to say the least, right now. So, I mean, it seems to be something that... It's his biggest problem. Let's face it, he's doing a really good job. Whether you like him or not, he's doing a good job. But he's having trouble with implementation and leaks. Because, I should say, implementation due to leaks. And things like Priebus, but we've already gone over that. My point is that these people were not banned. Okay, I love how they go on the Academy Awards and they talk about how Donald Trump is oppressing the freedom of speech. Meanwhile, they're trashing the president on arguably one of the two or three biggest nights of TV in the world. Yeah, Trump's really silencing what you're allowed to say. If Trump was like Hitler, you wouldn't have even gotten onto the television set before you found out what a jackboot was. Okay, we are not being oppressed every time we don't have our asses kissed. And I think that's important to point out. What Trump has done here is he has fired a number of news groups that have lied about him, that have accused him of cheating on his wife, in essence. See, that's the bigger story there. It wasn't that prostitutes were involved. It was that they implied that he cheated on his wife. I'm telling you now, you can just tell. That's what bothered Mr. Trump more than anything else. And lastly, he hasn't just brought in yes men and people that are going to be catering to what he wants. Politico's in there. Politico hates him. So with that bit of context in line here, let's read this, because the writer of the story, I do like blasting news, but this writer tends to be very anti-Trump. But when you think about the facts that I gave you, you'll see that he's off base. These people are not being silenced. Look up Mao, look up Stalin, look up people that really did silence somebody before you sound like an idiot. Just hours after bashing the news media during his speech at the Conservative Political Action Conference, of course CPAC, Donald Trump banned several news organizations from attending the latest White House press briefing on Friday. In response, several media outlets have decided to boycott his administration. Now, you notice they don't care when Milo Yiannopoulos got banned. Oh, but Sam, he's a pedophile. Let me tell you what. He's not exactly the most sexually moral man in the world, but neither am I. He's just gay and I'm not. No, I don't cheat, for those of you that know that I'm married, but my wife and I flirt. And, you know, maybe she's cute. I'm kidding, it's been a long time. But in any event, no, okay? I'm not going to come on here and pretend I'm some great moralist. However, I am a Christian, and so is Milo. And flawless ones we are not. But again, there is some gray area as to what sexual sin is. For instance, God didn't get mad at David. It's not listed in the Bible until David decided to steal a man's wife and send the husband into the battlefield to purposefully die. And then took his wife. Okay, that's a little bit different than having a threesome. His name was Uriah. Look it up. There wasn't a huge problem with it before, even with concubines, which we would consider today to be fornication. So, you know, the terms there are somewhat gray. But my bigger point of this is, I'm not going to get into that discussion now. If anybody wants to hear it, leave a discussion. Leave a comment. I'll do it on another show. Milo didn't get to speak because of something he said that he corrected, the only apology he's ever given. Now, people will say, well, he's just apologizing, Sam, to save his career. You're covering for it. I don't know. When he's 32, some reports say 34, which I didn't think was possible in this day and age, to not know how old somebody is, but they don't. All right. In 32 years of life, has he ever molested a kid, harmed a kid, or sexually harmed anybody whatsoever in any way? Okay, he's all gay and flamboyant, but if you look at him, the man's like 6 foot tall or bigger. He's huge. Which must be horrible for another gay guy. Ow, ow, ow! But in any event, you've got a very big guy that could very easily muscle over children or muscle over people that he wanted to hurt. Most offenders do not start offending at 32 years old. They have a history of offense before things get very bad. If Milo has an offense for hurting somebody, then fine. By all means, throw the book at him. However, if he does it, then he probably he's probably not an offender. He's probably somebody that misspoke, apologized for what he did, owned what he did, and didn't complain when he got fired for what he did. So he got silenced because he worded something terrible. Was it despicable? Yes. But he clarified it. He did not mean you should be out having sex with a 13-year-old. He meant that 13-year-olds do have sex. And that's not good either, but that's another topic for another day. Trump's media ban. Although I would have liked to have had sex at 13. When I was at 13, girls wouldn't have peed on me if I was on fire. Ever since his inauguration just over a month ago. Now I can't speak at CPAC. I meant when I was 13. Donald Trump has escalated his war on words with the mainstream media. Referring to the press as terrible, well, and dishonest, which I would say they have been towards him. The commander-in-chief has engaged in a heated feud with journalists that have only increased by the day. As news continues to trickle out about Trump's ties with Russia, of which now this article writer looks even dumber because we have established that there aren't any ties with Russia, and their possible involvement in American politics, of which we know there was none, the former host of The Apprentice decided to take drastic measures, as reported by the New York Times on February the 24th. Some of the most well-respected news organizations in the country and around the world have been banned from covering them. Respected by who? How can you respect someone that lies? He's not saying that you may not come back in and be part of the Washington Press Corps if you don't like me. That's not what he's saying. He's saying you may not be part of the Washington Press Corps if you lie about me. Okay, Politico and ABC are in here. Neither one of them like him at all. So, the notion that he's silencing somebody is simply fiction, friends. This article is skewed, and I do like blasting news because they let you write what you want. They don't tell you what to write, and they don't at conservative Daily Post either. But my point is, that's why I like writing for them. They let the person pick what they're writing about. So this is the way that this author sees it. So I can't say that I agree. Instead of the typical interaction with reporters at the press room, you of course briefing room, typical interaction with people that accused you of messing around on your wife with prostitutes, White House Press Secretary Sean Spicer took part in the so-called off-camera gaggle with select members of media. Yes, those that do not lie. Of those that were blocked or banned from the ban include the New York Times, need we say more, Politico did get banned on this particular route, The Hill, The Daily Mail, BuzzFeed, New York News, and the LA Times, and even the BBC. Now, see, the LA Times is actually somebody that ran with a poll that said that Trump was going to win. However, they're also the ones that did everything they could possibly do to post fake polls that were knowingly fake polls. And CNN did that. I just did a whole article about it for CDP. So look up Conservative Daily Post, CNN, fake news. Look up how they knew they ran with bad poll numbers to hurt Trump. And if you don't believe me, then go ahead and look up James O'Keefe. You don't have to believe me. I'm just letting you know what I found. It wasn't my find. I wish it was. Those who are allowed to take part in the briefing, I was wrong about Politico on this particular route, included right-wing news outlets, Breitbart, and One America News Network, in addition to some mainstream media. Someone needs to tell this guy from Blasting here that CBS, Fox, and ABC were invited. Now, Fox, you could argue, is somewhat right-minded, but CBS and ABC, they've hated Trump forever. Also invited to attend the gaggle were Time Magazine, who hates Trump, and the Associated Press. But they decided to boycott, in part, because they refused to appear. So there's two leftist groups that didn't show up that were invited. Vanity Fair, another very leftist fucking screed mag, excuse me, oof, that flipped, also has spoken out and included themselves in the boycott. Well, imagine that. Moving forward, when Donald Trump was only in office for a month, his relationship press doesn't appear to be stable enough to work together in the future. Now, that's not true at all. He's going to work with anybody that doesn't lie about him. I'm sorry. You may not be in the Washington Press Corps if you have slandered the president and he has to look at you every day while you accused him of messing with urine and prostitutes. And yes, that is the story that was rambling. Not to mention that the press corps is believed to be the source of many of the leaks. That's why Spicer, and I'll be writing about this later, that's why Spicer, it's been talking about cell phone problems, is a good way to put it. He's been taking the cell phones off of people in the press corps. That, and then we're making the First Amendment. No, you know when you go into the White House, you sign papers that say that they're allowed to look at your phone for any reason. Otherwise, that's how dead presidents happen. That's how leaks happen. And you do not have the right to your own cell phone. For one thing, much of what's done is a Freedom of Information Act ordeal with many of the people that work in there. And they're not allowed to use certain apps that are encrypted and delete themselves. In other words, if they do, then the public won't have access to their leaders' information. And by being our leaders, they have to give us that information according to the law of the land. Frontmag.com, as long as it's not classified. Iraq Archbishop wonders where protesters were when Christians were dying. Now, this I found on the third, but I'm going to go ahead and stay with it because it makes a lot of sense. Muslim lives matter. Non-Muslim lives don't matter. That's how Islam and the left both see it. And this is very telling here, friends. Catholic Archbishop Bashar Wardy of Erbil tells Crooks that Iraqi refugees see a lot differently than we do and wonder where the protesters were in 2014. Everyone, including the administration, seems to agree that this should have been implemented with more clarity. There was much more confusion about what the order meant, and many people were very upset. From my perspective in Iraq, I wonder why all of these protesters, he's talking about the travel ban, were not protesting in the streets when ISIS came to kill Christians and Yazidis and other minority groups. Thankfully, friends, I can say with an honest face that I have been on here telling you about that since day one. They are not protesting when tens of thousands of displaced Christians my archdiocese has cared for since 2014 received no financial assistance from the U.S. government nor the U.N. Oh, that I did not know. There were no protests when Syrian Christians were only let in at a rate that was 20 times less than the percentage of their population in Syria. That's not true, friends. It's actually worse than that. It's far worse than 20 times. I do not understand why some Americans are now so upset that many majority communities that faced a horrible genocide will finally get a degree of priority this summer. The average lefty is convinced that Christians are evil oppressors, Muslims are poor persecuted victims. That's why it's all right for Obama to impose a de facto Christian ban on refugees from Syria so that 99% of those who were allowed in were Muslims. Christians being killed was not the problem for them. Now, you might say that that's an overreaction. Well, it's not an overreaction. Almost all of the people to whom that have started Christianity have been slaughtered. Their numbers have gone down incredibly. Now, for all of you whiny lefties that like to say, we stole the land from the Indians, which is somewhat true. We really did. Then again, they were fighting each other at such a high rate and killing each other. Before we ever got here to kill them, they were killing each other. So they probably would have beaten just a few of these dumb whiteys that got off the boat and didn't know how to cook a turkey without their help. They probably would have defeated us quite easily if they had not been fighting amongst themselves. But in any event, we stole their land. Okay, why isn't there any outrage here that Muslims, radical Muslims, but still Muslims, are stealing historical Christian lands? These lands belonged to the Christians long before Muslims were even born. Before Muhammad was ever looking at small children. Yeah, I guess I said that out loud, didn't I? Friends, you're listening, it's true, unfortunately, you're listening to the correct views, only got a couple of stories left. I want to let you know that this is all brought to you by Change Transportation. If you're going to call Uber, don't call Uber, call Change Transportation instead. However, if Uber does what they're about to do, I'm sorry, Kenny, I think I'm going to call Uber. Why? Why would I do that? Breitbart, Uber hires NASA engineer for vital flying car project. Do you know what that means? That means that we have, for the first time in a very long time, a flying car update. Is there anything better? For those of you that don't know, and I'm going to start doing this again, I used to save $1 a day when I went to work for the flying car, and I'm going to start doing it now that I have a job to do it again, so that I can buy in at least to somebody else's flying car one day. I am obsessed with all things to do with the flying car, and now we've got NASA involved. I just did a story yesterday for the Conservative Daily Post that talks about how NASA is coming up with new engine propulsion systems to replace the Concorde, which is actually slower than the Concorde, but there's a noise pollution problem with the Concorde. Oh, shut the hell up. Don't live in an airplane route then. Really, if you live in an airport route, you should not complain about the noise of airplanes, or just don't live in line with the airplane route. Plain and simple. Don't live by the airport. But no, they shut it down. So NASA's got new rockets coming out that can help with Lockheed Martin, who wants to build these new supersonic jets. And I had said that I thought that people like Elon Musk was going to go ahead with SpaceX and move ahead maybe even quicker than NASA is in some regards, whether travel-related breakthroughs or not. Well, we're seeing NASA here getting into the flying car business. It'll be interesting to see if SpaceX has anything to offer. Uber has hired NASA engineer Mark Moore as Director of Engineering for the Flying Car Project, Uber Elevate, which seeks to expand the cab service into airborne travel. I will still work for Uber if this happens. My life goal now is to work for Uber. I never thought it would be. Moore worked at NASA as an advanced aircraft engineer and basically kickstarted the current interest in the vertical takeoff and landing craft for short-haul urban flight with a 2010 paper on a feasibility of a helicopter-like vehicle. Now, these are different. The flying car itself actually flies for you. All you got to do is find a runway and let it do its own thing. It's even got parachutes in the event that something were to go wrong up there. The engineer was impressed by Uber's work on the subject and saw a chance to make the vision he'd originally articulated years ago into something real in a reasonable time scale, which is good, according to TechCrunch. Moore said that the decision to join Uber was that the company seemed to have a practical business case for making the flying commuter transit service real, and nothing would ever get done without market motivation behind the vision. Well, Uber has done quite a bit in a short amount of time. They planned for the flying service for first hinted at in September of 2016. That was by their chief product officer, Jeff Holden. So they've even got their own product officer in the transportation company, so I would argue they're pretty serious about it. They don't tend to hire people that make products for transportation companies very often. In an interview, Holden shared his interest in vertical takeoff and landing vehicles, claiming it could change cities and how we work and live. He added that he wanted to offer his customers as many options as possible to move around, and that passenger drone technology could be fully functional and norm within a decade. That very well could be. A drone would pick you up and it would be flown by somebody else. I could very well see that happening. I hadn't thought of it before. Voltol is another VTOL to do that, he says, after taking off talking about ways to decrease city traffic. So they're excited about it. In a 2015 paper with rapper Jay-Z, it says, and other high-profile individuals, including Saudi Arabian's family, invested $20 million in JetSmarter, which has been billed as the Uber for flying, while an Israeli tech is prepared to launch their passenger-carrying drone service in 2020. Excellent news, friends. Absolutely excellent news. Now again, I don't think we're going to be flying around in ways that we see in science fiction movies. I really don't. I think there's going to be lanes that you have to stick to. There'll probably be, if you don't have a pilot's license, you'll have to do one of these that fly themselves, or you'll have to get a flying car license. Because they can't have people crashing over homes and things like that. So I don't imagine you're going to get to fly them immediately. They're going to be the self-driving ones that hit first, I think. But we'll see. It's interesting. There'll be places opening up where these things can take off and land. And if you think that sounds too far-fetched, people didn't think there would be gas stations on every corner either. You gotta make a bomb on every street corner. Look it up. That's what they thought. Friends, that brings us to... Oh, no, it doesn't bring us to the dumb D of the day. Yeah, yes it does. The dumb D of the day! Ah, Christelle, that sounds beautiful. No, it doesn't. Alright, guys, let's hear it. The You Are an Idiot song. You can donate to the show at thecorrectviews@hotmail.com, at paypal.com. Oh, yes. Alright, who gets the You Are an Idiot today? You know, how many of you have eaten at Popeyes? I actually really like Popeyes, but I also like really gross stories and dumbies, and Popeyes managed to bring me all of them. This is also from Blasting News. Jonathan Hawk, woman in Texas gets served flesh-eating screwworms at Popeyes. It sounds like the bugs that got into Michelle Obama's safe broccoli lunches. Remember that? A lawsuit filed against the chain claims the parasites ate her from the inside out. Dun, dun, dun. Rice and beans were added with added flesh-eating screwworms. Were what one Texas woman got when she ordered the common side dish at the popular fast food chain Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen. Karen Good of San Antonio got a good meal and is now suing the restaurant chain and its local franchise for 1 million smackers. This is for damages for medical expenses, pain and suffering, mental anguish, and loss of enjoyment of life. Oh, I ate a bar of my mental mind. I know what she meant. I'm making fun of her, but she's not the dummy. She deserves every penny she's getting. It's just funny. How do you not notice a screw worm? Unless you're, I think, Don't blame the victim, Sam. I'm sorry. I've got to reply that she might not be much smarter than the Screwworm. I don't know. Let's see how it was put inside. This is kind of a reaction video. I didn't read the whole thing. Feeding on her insides. I wish Arg had a reason to come out. If you don't know who he is, look up Arg Mortis. The lawsuit filed last week in Bexar County District Court claims Miss Good was served a meal from the local Popeye's restaurant that was contaminated with flesh-eating insects known as New World Screwworms. Screwworms, Ministry, New World Order, anybody. After unknowingly consuming and scavenging bugs, they laid eggs in the lining of Miss Good's small intestines. Once the eggs hatched, the carnivorous, that would be meat eaters for you Russia, like Kesha fans, the carnivorous meat eaters, the creatures infested her body and started feeding on her from the inside out. Now they've said it three times. According to the 10-page lawsuit, think of the movie Alien. Popeyes knew about the flesh-eating worm. Here, I'm going to bring my alien out for this. There he is, he's helping you. Popeyes knew about the flesh-eating worm. Yeah, of course they did. Patrick Stolmeyer said his client lost significant amounts of blood and tissue as the insects grew inside of her. Good and her attorney contend that local Popeyes franchisee and its foods were aware of the parasite contamination before she ate it in the spring of 2015. Stolmeyer, like, I have to admire your stool if I was a flesh-eating bug. He argues that employees at the restaurant were not trained to effectively inspect, remove, and recall any potentially tainted food. He also contends that the workers disregarded safety protocol, likely knew the flesh-eating bugs were in the food, and ignored the risk of injury to Mrs. Good. Now, they have nothing there that implies that they did know that it was in there. Lack of training does not mean that they knew that it was in there. However, the body invasion caused an E. coli infection, ow, and peptic ulcers, double ow. Mrs. Good, the screw worm eater, had to have surgery, and one of her arms is, partially paralyzed. Yeah, at least $1 million, probably more than that. She has suffered the loss of her business, her home, and vehicles. Now she is trying to heal and get her life back together since the horrible ordeal. Still, how do they think they knew it? I don't get it. And that's important. You can't say that someone deliberately knew about something without any proof to it. But I'd still say she's entitled to much more than $1 million for having eaten one of these. Moving on. Parasite infestation not possible. Popeyes has publicly responded to the lawsuit saying Mrs. Good's claim is unfounded and false. They are working closely with the franchise to investigate the matter and maintain that all Popeyes restaurants adhere to stringent food safety procedures that would make it possible for the parasite to live through the cooking process. Let's face it, friends, they do deep fry everything there. We know that. I wouldn't be surprised if they deep fried their pop. So, I mean, I don't know here. I guess I'm just not sold on the screwworm story. Last paragraph. In the 1950s, it was an unlikely but deadly source. The U.S. government created a radical birth control program to destroy the screwworm population nationwide. The program worked, and by the 1960s, the parasite had vanished from the country. However, screwworms were discovered in deer from National Key Deer Range in Florida last year. While humans were very rarely affected by screwworms, they will cause death if left untreated. So, not only are they very rare, most people at the Popeyes restaurant probably hadn't seen a screwworm before, but we're supposed to believe that they knowingly served it to somebody and now her life is destroyed. If they did, she's worthy of every penny. I, my friends, am a skeptic, but there is somebody getting the dumb knee of the day in there. You can rest assured of it. All right, friends, thank you for listening to The Correct Views. Sam, I beat the Gangi jumping off here. Please do me a favor. Donate, if you can, at thecorrectviews@hotmail.com through PayPal. Every penny that you give to me goes towards a better show, and that is, of course, what I aim, hope, pray, and strive to bring you. Be careful. Don't drink anything given to you by Vladimir Putin, and try not to eat any screwworms.